Well, I agree with whoever said that up there. That was beautiful. So thank you so much, Connie and JP, for that music. And welcome and good morning to everyone out there. If you don't know me, my name is Reverend Jordan McKenzie, and I have the honor of serving as the lead pastor here at Belmont United Methodist Church. So welcome to our service this morning, whether you're here in person or you're watching us online. We're so glad that you've chosen to join with us this weekend. And I do want to say a very, very happy July 4th weekend to you. I hope that you're having a very enjoyable weekend and also a safe weekend this July 4th holiday. I know it's a little bit different this year with the COVID virus, but I still hope you're having a great weekend. I also want to remind everyone of just a couple quick announcements today. First of all, we will have a church council meeting tomorrow night at 6:30 p.m. up in the multipurpose room. So if you're on the church council, just a reminder that we will be having our meeting tomorrow night. Also, today we will be taking communion, which is the first time in several months we've been able to have communion together. And of course, we're doing it a little bit differently. We have the packets that you should have received on the way in. And so we'll be taking those a little bit later in the service after the sermon. I'll explain at that point how to do it. But if you are joining us online, you are welcome to participate. Obviously, you don't have those packets with you there. But if you want to take some juice and some crackers at home and use those, you can join with us. We'd love to have you do that. So once again, welcome everyone, and let's begin our worship service today with our opening prayer. And I'm going to read this. So let's stand together as I read this for us. Hear now this prayer. O God, our Lord and Creator, you have blessed us with each other so we can support and help one another. You have blessed us with others so that we can grow into the disciples that you have called us to be. You have blessed us with this church to be our strength in times of blessing and times of need. Help us to rely not on our own understanding, but on you and those who you have put in our lives. Amen.
Well, as you remain standing, please continue in worship by joining us in our opening hymn, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrimage. Secure from all alone.
may be seated. It's a great day to be in worship, amen? Man, that means it's a great day to go to our God in prayer. So will you bow your head with me this morning as we continue in worship by going to our God in prayer? Oh God, once again, we thank you that we can be here this morning. We are so thankful, so grateful that we can be gathered together. We know that it's a holiday weekend and there are many people on vacation, many people out with other weekend plans. So there may not be a whole lot of us here this morning, but we are glad that we can be here, O Lord, in your presence, studying your word, singing praise to you. O God, thank you. Thank you for that. And O God, on this holiday weekend, we do thank you for our country. We thank you for all the rights and the freedoms we have. We thank you for all the prosperity, for all the innovation, for all the amazing things that this country means to each and every one of us, O Lord. We do live in a great country, and we thank you for that. We praise you, O Lord, for our country. We celebrate our country on this July 4th weekend. And we thank you for all the people that continue to make our country strong, for all the police and the military who have served and continue to serve, for all the public servants, for all the first responders, for all the people, both in the government and in civil service, in our community and in Washington, D.C., everywhere around this country. It's the people that make this country great, O Lord. And so we thank you for the people of this nation. We celebrate them and we thank you for their service today, O Lord. We pray on this July 4th weekend as we do celebrate our country, as we do remember how lucky we are, how blessed we are to be a part of this great nation, we pray that you would help us to also continue to strive to become an even more perfect union, to work towards fairness and justice for all people. Oh Lord, allow us to make this an even better country. Help us to continue along that path. Help us to continue moving forward to the dreams and the visions of the founders so that we can truly fulfill them in this great nation. Oh Lord, we also continue to pray for those in other countries as well who don't have all the rights and the privileges that we have in the United States of America. We pray for those around the world that may be the case for, whether it's those in places in Latin America or Africa or Asia or Europe. Many people live in poverty. Many people live under authoritarian governments. Many people cannot get up and do the things that we do each and every day. And so we remember them today. We pray for them. We pray that one day they would come to know the same rights, the same way of life that we have, O Lord. And as we pray for our country and for all other countries today, we also pray, lastly, for those right here in our own community, in our church. We pray for those who have many different challenges in their lives. Oh Lord, we know that we all have challenges, so each and every one of us could lift up our request this morning. But we pray especially for those that are in our community. We pray for those with family issues, those who need reconciliation. We pray for those who have struggles at work. Perhaps they are in a bad work environment. They don't like their job. They're not fulfilled in their job. Perhaps they just need a job. We pray for those who have health challenges or face illness today. We pray especially for Denny Duff, who had a knee replacement surgery, O Lord, this week. We pray that you would continue to strengthen and encourage him, and for many others that continue to have health issues, O Lord, big and small. And yes, we, of course, continue to pray for all those who are dealing with the COVID virus as well. Those who may have it, those who have loved ones who may have it, those who are working in our hospitals and doctor's offices. Lord, we lift them up. We pray that you would continue to be with them, continue to give them strength, O Lord. We know that this has been happening now for several months, and many of us thought perhaps it would be gone by now, and it's not. So we pray that you would give those who are on the front lines the strength to endure. O Lord, today as we lift up all these requests in your name. We also come before you to pray the prayer that your Son, our Savior Jesus, taught us to pray so many years ago, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We have a scripture reading this morning that I would like to read for us, and this is another psalm. This is Psalm 150. So hear now this word. It says, Praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in the mighty heavens. Praise Him for His acts of power. Praise Him for His surpassing greatness. Praise Him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise Him with the harp and the lyre. Praise Him with the timbre and dancing. Praise Him with the strings and pipe. Praise Him with the clash of cymbals. Praise Him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. This is God's word for us today. Amen? Amen. Well, let us now stand and do just that. Let us stand and sing to our Lord.
O Church of God, united to serve one common Lord, proclaim to all one message with hearts in glad accord. Christ ever goes before us, we follow day by day, with strong and eager footsteps along the upward way. From every land and nation, the ordered ranks appear to serve one valiant leader. They come from far and near. They chant their one confession. They praise one living Lord and place their sure dependence upon His saving word. Though creeds and tongues may differ, they speak, O Christ, of Thee, and in Thy loving Spirit we shall one people be. Lord, may our faithful service and singleness of aim proclaim to all the power of Thy redeeming name. May Thy great power be answered, that we may all be one, close bound by love, united in Thee, God's blessed Son, to bring a single witness, to make the pathway broad, hope in darkness may find the one true light.
You may be seated. Or if you want, you can stand for my sermon too. It's up to you. I'm glad somebody liked it. Will you bow your heads once again with me this morning? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, as we all know, last week was the first week that we were able to hold in-person worship services for several months, and it was wonderful to be able to worship together. I think having been apart for so long has given us a greater appreciation for being able to worship together. At least I think so. Don't you appreciate being able to worship together more than you did just a few months ago? Yeah, I think so. But more than that, I think we now also have a greater appreciation for the gift of being involved in faith community itself. It's a gift to be part of a faith community. And that's good to think about because sometimes I think we take our faith community, our church, for granted. Or perhaps even more than that, we forget how important it is to be involved in a church. You know, there are many folks who think that the church really isn't that important to walking with Jesus. Sure, they may say, it's nice to go to church if you want, or perhaps if you feel it's personally edifying or helpful to you. But it's really kind of optional. And I'm speaking here of Christians in general, not just Christians in our church, but Christians in general. This is the attitude that many folks have. In fact, I want to illustrate this with a quote from, of all people, Justin Bieber. You all know Justin Bieber, right? The pop sensation. So he's actually a Christian. And a few years ago, he was asked some questions about his faith and the church. And he said this. He said, a lot of people who are religious, I think they get lost. They go to church just to go to church. And I would agree with that. Many people do just go through the motions. They forget why they're really going to church, what it's all about. I'm right there with them when he says that. But then he said this. He said, I'm not trying to disrespect them, but for me, I just focus more on praying and talking to Him. I don't have to go to church. For me, I just focus on praying and talking to Him. I don't have to go to church. And isn't that the attitude of many people in our culture today? I'll share a statistic to back that up. 65% of Americans self-identify as Christians. Yet less than 37% of Americans go to church regularly. 65% are Christians, but yet less than 37% go to church regularly. That means that almost half of those who consider themselves Christians don't go to church regularly. You know, perhaps they think, oh, I'm a Christian, but I don't really need to go to church. I pray every day. I read my Bible, or I watch Joel Osteen or Joyce Meyer on TV. And I'm certainly not putting that down. I think it's great to do those things. That's wonderful. But just relying on that alone, on praying or reading your scripture or watching a TV preacher on your TV alone by yourself as a solitary individual is not really the biblical way. When Jesus called the disciples, he didn't just ask his disciples to come and follow him individually, all by themselves. He called them to follow him together. They went out and spent their time together. They ate together and traveled together. He taught them together. You'll remember the Last Supper, for instance. They were together eating that Last Supper because that's how they lived their lives as followers of Jesus. And Jesus sent them out together to do ministry in groups, it says. Because as Scripture says, iron sharpens iron. That's the model that Jesus gave us. Later, when Paul went out and spread the message of Jesus, he founded churches. Communities of faith where people likewise lived out their faith together. That's what we see when Christianity was started, actually, on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. You know, there was the day of Pentecost, right? We just celebrated that a few weeks ago. And that was when the Holy Spirit came upon all the people. It didn't happen when they were at home, sitting alone together, or alone, separately, all by themselves in their homes. But it's when they were gathered together in one place that the Lord came upon them. The Holy Spirit touched them. And then as a result of that day of Pentecost, as a result of what the Spirit did in their midst when they were gathered together, it says they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread together in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. You see the theme there? They shared their lives together in fellowship. Because the idea was, and always has been, that the faith community, the church, is the primary vehicle that God uses to sustain and help people follow Jesus. Because it's just hard, just too hard, to do it by ourselves. There are too many temptations around us that can take us down a bad path. Too many other voices competing for our attention. Too many things that can distract us, that can cause us to doubt. I mean, if I didn't go to church for a few months, if I just watched the news all the time and what's happening around me, man, I don't think I would last too long. I don't think it would be too long before I started to get apathetic in my faith and start acting in some ways that aren't really too faithful to who I want to be. It's too hard to keep the faith all by yourself if you don't have others in your life lifting you up. You remember when Jesus says the Holy Spirit will be with us? You remember what he says? He says, whenever two or three of you are gathered together. Whenever two or three of you are gathered together, that's when the Holy Spirit will come in our midst and work in our lives. See, I think God speaks to us in a different way. God's Spirit can work in a different way when we have others there around us speaking in our lives. Amen? That's what it's all about. Not just living a life of faith by ourselves as a solitary individual, but by doing it with others in community. Yes, it's just too hard to do it by ourselves. I mean, just look over the last few months when we haven't been at church. It's just not the same sitting at home and watching it on a computer or a tablet every week. There's something that happens when we're able to interact with one another physically and hear each other singing and praying and smiling and saying amen. There's just a different experience there. Just ask someone who lives in a foreign country where Christianity is illegal and they can't meet with others. Just ask them how hard it is to live out their faith without that community in their lives. Christianity is inherently a social and a communal faith. The theologian Stanley Hauerwas says, there is no such thing as Lone Ranger Christianity. And you know, really, the idea that you can just follow Jesus on your own and in sort of a do-it-yourself way without surrounding yourself with the church family would have been a totally foreign concept up until a couple hundred years ago. It's a very modern notion. If you just read the church fathers and most people throughout church history, it's simply assumed that Christians are deeply involved in the church. Here's a quote from St. Augustine, probably the greatest saint ever in church history. He said, "You cannot have God as your father without having the church as your mother. You cannot have God as your father without having the church as your mother." Now that might be a little harsh sounding, but I think the point is well taken, isn't it? The point is that our relationship with God and our involvement in the church are inseparable. And that's always been the assumption throughout church history. What happened was that after the Enlightenment and modern society, it changed so that the individual became the most important. The individual became king. And the most important thing, it was said, is for each one of us as individuals to be able to be the master of our own choices and our own desires, to free ourselves from any sort of external authority outside of ourselves. That's what modern society teaches us. But for Christians, in baptism, when we become part of the church, we submit ourselves to a community of faith that holds us accountable. The paradox of Christian belief is that to become all that we were created to be, we need others to help us with that. And that's why we need the church, the faith community. See, the church community is a blessing. It's a gift. It's a gift, amen? Amen? It's a gift to be able to study the Word together, to hear other perspectives on it besides just our own, to have people who hold us accountable, to have people who bear our burdens with us, to have people who serve with us. It's a gift to share our lives together. It's a gift. And you know, there's a lot of imagery about that in the Bible, particularly in the New Testament. There's a lot of imagery in the New Testament about the body of Christ. You remember what it says, don't you? It says, the church is like a body and we're all different parts. We each have our own unique function. We each have different callings, different gifts, but we're all just a part of the body. The body cannot function without us, and we cannot function without the rest of the body. As it says in 1 Corinthians 21, the eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you. And the head cannot say to the foot, I don't need you. We can't say that. What a beautiful image the body of Christ is. What a beautiful thing it is to be a part of it. Yes, a church community is a gift. It is what we need, all of us. And I get that some people have a lot of baggage with the church. You know, they've been hurt by the church. Or it's legitimately hard to get to church because of their work schedule. Or maybe they're caring for family or whatnot. Maybe they get anxious around people. I get all of that. I'm just saying that we should be striving to surround ourselves with the church community if we want to be faithful to Christ, because this is the model, the example that He gave to us as Christians. And that's actually why I insisted that we had our worship services on Sunday morning when we had them virtually. You know, I saw a lot of other churches that taped them before Sunday morning, and they would send them out to their members, and their members could watch them at their own convenience individually whenever they wanted. And I definitely see the advantage of that. I mean, as a pastor, it would be a lot easier for me not to be here every Sunday morning. But for me, I thought it was really important that we at least try to worship all at once together on Sunday mornings, even if it was online. I thought it was important that we did that in real space and time together, that we still have that shared sense of being a church together. I thought that was really important. And you know, as we think about this today, about the importance of sharing our lives together as followers of Christ, I can't think of a better way to celebrate being together today, whether we're here in person or we're watching online, than to partake of communion today. Because communion is something that is inherently a shared experience. It's a shared experience. We take the bread and the juice in unison, remembering Christ's sacrifice for all of us. We come to the table together with open hearts, remembering the reason that we're all here together. So as we take communion today, let it be a reminder to us, a symbol to us of our togetherness, of our shared life together. Amen? Amen. Well, I'm going to invite the praise team to once again play a song for us to prepare our hearts today as we get ready to partake of communion.
all start out on the outside, the outside looking in. This is where grace begins. We were hungry, we were thirsty, with nothing left to give. Oh, the shape that we were in. Just when all hope seems lost, love opened the door for us. He said, come to the table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be set free. Come to the table. Come join this motley crew of misfits, these liars and these thieves. There's no one unwelcome here. That sin and shame that you brought with you, you can leave it at the door and let mercy draw you near. And come to the table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place. To the thief and to the doubter, to the hero and the coward, to the prisoner and the soldier, to the young and to the older, all who hunger, all who thirst, all the last and all the first, all the paupers, all the princes, all who failed, you've been forgiven, all who dream and all who wonder, all who've loved and lost another, all the chained and all the free, all who follow, all who lead, anyone who's been let down, all the lost you have been found, all who've been right and wrong, to anyone who hears this song. Come to the table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place
to invite you at this time to take your communion elements out, whether you're online or you're here in person. And this is the first time as a pastor that I've led communion with these little packets, so we'll see how this goes. Cross your fingers and hope it goes all right. So you'll see there are two layers. There's the first layer that you have to pull up, and then there's the wafer. And so we'll partake of that in just a minute. Don't do it yet. We'll partake of that in just a minute. And then after that, there's a second layer that you pull up, and then you drink the juice following that. Let us now prepare our hearts to partake of these elements. You know, what matters is not the actual elements that we have in our hand. It doesn't matter if it's real bread or a wafer. It doesn't matter if it's real wine or grape juice. What matters is that Jesus is really present here at the table. Amen? In fact, it doesn't even matter if we actually have a table here, because Jesus himself is the table. Jesus himself is the one who is offering himself. We remember what happened so many years ago. It was nearly 2,000 years ago, actually, on that Thursday evening at that Last Supper. Jesus and his disciples were gathered there together, just as we were talking about this morning. They were gathered together, sharing their lives. Jesus knew that it was just about time for him to be betrayed by one of his own, and then arrested, and then ultimately put to death. So when he was with his disciples that evening, he had some bread. And he took that bread, he broke it, and he said, "Eat this. This is my body given for you." And then he had some wine. And after they had eaten that bread, he took the chalice, held it up, and said, "This is my blood shed for you, given for you. Drink in remembrance of me." And so today, all these many years later, on this July 4th Sunday morning, we too partake of those same elements, the body and blood of Christ, remembering anew his sacrifice for each and every one of us. He died for you and for me. And just as the song said just a second ago, he died to set us free, to rid us of our guilt and our shame, our past, whatever it is. He says, "Put that away. You are now a new creation in me. I died for you because I love you." That's what he says to you on this morning. Will you pray with me? Oh Jesus, today we do remember your sacrifice in our behalf. We remember the great love that you had for each of us, to go to that cross, to go to Calvary for us, to experience that torment, that agony, to experience death for us because you loved each and every one of us. Oh Lord, we can never repay you enough, but we do thank you today. We pray that we would be worthy to eat and drink of these elements. And we pray now that you would pour down your Holy Spirit. Pour it down on these elements so we would be changed and transformed, filled up by your Spirit as we eat and we drink them. Oh Lord, be with us today. Be present in a real way in this sanctuary, right here at Belmont Church and beyond in our homes this morning. We pray this in your name, and all God's people said, Amen. I invite you now to open up your cup and take out the wafer. This is Christ's body given for you. Let us eat. Now we can open up the cup. This is Christ's blood shed for you. Take and drink. Amen. Thanks be to God.
I invite you to stand and join us in our closing hymn, number 620, One Bread, One Body.
One Lord of all. one body in this one Lord. Gentile or Jew, servant or free, woman or man,
this benediction. This morning we celebrated communion for the first time in several months. We remember Jesus' sacrifice on our behalf. But yet we also remember that the story didn't end there, did it? No, because Jesus resurrected. He rose from the dead. And that means that even today, right now, right here, Jesus is still alive. He is active, living, and loving us. Jesus is with us even now. So go in that hope, and go and remember that we are called to be His body together. We are His body here in the church, and we are His body when we go out into the world. Continue to be part of His one body. Continue to be a witness to His love as you depart. Go in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.